Hi, my name is Carrie Price. I'm the Health Professions Librarian for Towson University's Cook Library, and today we're going to talk about searching for evidence or research in the health professions, and I've provided you with a framework for effective searching. My contact information is here and the Cook Library homepage, which is libraries.towson.edu. So we're going to work through the process like this. We're going to go a little bit fast because I don't want this video to be too long. So the guide that this comes from that I have created is linked here. It's a research guide for you. And so first we're going to assess the topic, scope, goals. We're going to brainstorm search terms, choose the resources we want to search, document the search, and evaluate the evidence. So first we'll do the slides, and then we'll do a little bit of live searching. So to assess your project, you need to think about what topic you're interested in. What kind of assignment is this? Is this a big project, a small project? Is it an annotated bibliography? And do you want to find all the literature that's ever been written? Unlikely. Or some of the really good literature that's been written? And what do you already know about this topic? And what can you see from the field, from a little bit of probing? What has been written and where might there be some gaps? So you're going to work on gathering some background information just to help you understand the topic a little bit better. So CQ Researcher is a scholarly version of Wikipedia, kind of, and it kind of is lacking in the medical field, health professions, so you may not find what you want there. But we also have Gale Virtual Library and Sage Knowledge. They're a bit like scholarly encyclopedias, and you know even Wikipedia can have value if you use it right. So if you do find a Wikipedia page, you're not citing it, you're not quoting it, you need to look at the cited reference list at the bottom of every Wikipedia page. It is a crowdsource tool, but people are required to cite their research or to cite their sources. So if you know how to use Wikipedia, it can have value. CQ, Gale, and Sage are all available under the Databases button on the Towson Libraries homepage, which is libraries.towson.edu. So we're going to talk quickly about topic development. These are just some frameworks for coming up with an answerable, feasible, viable research topic or research question. And why would you do that? Because it's going to inform the way that you search later on. So you might find that outlining the most important components of your research topic it's going to help you make an effective search. And that's what we're talking about today, effective searching. So CocoaPop, you're going to outline or identify your condition, your context, your population. PO, population exposure outcomes. PICO, used a lot in clinical settings. Population, intervention, comparison or control, outcomes, and WWH, who, what, how. Now when we search with, or when we come up with these topic frameworks, and then you go to search, you don't have to use every single component of the framework. So we're going to use a search later on about dyslexia and ADHD or ADDH, attention deficit disorder with hyperactivity in school-aged children. And we use all three concepts, but maybe it would make sense just to search with dyslexia and attention deficit disorder with hyperactivity because that population is primarily school-aged children to begin with. And the same with PICO, population, intervention, comparison, or control, and outcomes. You might be looking at your population and your intervention or exposure, and you don't have to search the outcomes because you don't know what they are yet. You don't want to bias your search, so you don't need to search with every element of these frameworks. Brainstorm your search terms. So there are a lot of ways to say the same thing. So especially in health professions, especially in the medical field, you have synonyms, acronyms, initialisms, different spellings. And you got to think of them because if you don't search with them, you're not going to find the literature. So, for example, autism might be referred to as autism spectrum disorder, ASD. People who have been diagnosed with autism might be called autistic or autistics as a plural. If you're looking for the prevention of something, the prevention of aphasia, you might also be looking at the causes of aphasia. And then speech therapy, wow, that's a big topic. We could be looking at speech therapy, speech therapist, speech language pathology, speech language pathologist, SLP, language therapy. So there's lots of ways to describe that field, and the narrower you can get, the better. So the next thing is to choose your databases and resources. So you did some background research with the scholarly encyclopedias, scholarly Wikipedia. You might get started in Cook OneSearch, where you're just going to look and see what's been written. And then you're going to probably want to get more specialized. So searching databases like PubMed, which contains Medline. It's from the U.S. National Library of Medicine. CINAHL, which is a nursing and allied health literature database. And PsycINFO from the American Psychological Association, focused on psychological and psychiatric literature. So if you have a topic that is maybe conducive to one of these other databases, you might want to look in a specialized resource. So your research guides have a lot of these resources listed. Both the audiology and the speech language pathology guide have a databases and resources section with links to broad interdisciplinary databases and specialized databases. So then you're going to learn to search like a pro, and that's through trial and error. It's not an easy process. You're not going to get it right on the first try, but you're going to try your search, you're going to revise your search, and then you're going to try again. And it's important going in or through practice that you understand things like how to combine search terms and how to use database filters. And I'm going to highly recommend that you capture what you did so that it's reproducible. So you're going to document your search, the date that you did it, what filters you applied, what search terms you use, and how many results you got, because that's going to help you know how you found what you found. So let's talk about combining search terms. We have and, we have or, we have not. These are often called Boolean operators. And narrows your search down. So you're going to use and between two opposing concepts. So in this sample that I gave, we're going to look for dyslexia and ADDH, or attention deficit disorder with hyperactivity. Or broadens your search, so you're going to use it to add synonyms. So you may look for dyslexia or dyslexias or dyslexic. So or gives you more and narrows your search down, helps you find the overlap between two words or two concepts. Not can exclude specific terms, and I don't recommend actually using it very much at all. You may end up excluding something you wanted to see. So I don't use not very often, but you can use it in certain situations, and you'll know when you get to that point when you're searching. Most databases have filters that appear on the left-hand side, and these are things like publication or article type, language, date range, and so you can use those to narrow your search. Let's say you ran a search, you got 300 results. That's way too many for you to look through. So you're going to look for specific article types. You might look for systematic reviews, which are considered a high level of evidence because they're very rigorous. You may look for randomized controlled trials or controlled clinical trials or cohort studies or things like that. Or you may be looking just for peer-reviewed literature that shows up in academic journals. You might limit to the languages you can read. Like for me, that's English. And your date range. So the field is changing. Lots of medical and health fields are changing rapidly. So you might be looking at just the past 5 or 10 years and not be interested in what was published 40 years ago. The last step is to evaluate the evidence, and these are some frameworks for doing so. Of course, there's always CRAAP, which is currency, relevancy, accuracy, authority, and purpose. How current is the literature? How relevant is the literature to your topic? Is it accurate? Does it have authority? Who's writing this piece? Are they an expert? And purpose. Do they have an ulterior motive? What's their motivation for writing this piece? SIFT asks you to stop and investigate before you go any further. Find a better source if that source isn't good. And of course, always trace all quotes, context, media back to the original source. So if you find an article that has a quote from another article, you need to find that original article. You can't quote it from the second article. I hope that makes sense, but I'm sure you'll run into it in your career as a college student or a graduate student or a researcher. So for primary research, there are two sets of checklists that I really like. One is from the Critical Appraisal Skills Program, and one is from Joanna Briggs Institute. And they are both checklists for primary research, and they have things like systematic reviews, randomized controlled trials, cohort studies, case series, qualitative research. So it's like maybe 5 to 10 questions to prompt you to read that article or that research objectively, be able to answer these short, brief questions to understand if the methodology was sound, if the conclusions are appropriate based on how they did what they did. So those are two really great sets of checklists that you might end up using further on down the line. Reading research, hopefully there's a structured abstract. Sometimes there's an unstructured abstract, and that's going to tell you what this article is about. And if you read that and you say, well, this still sounds interesting, then please proceed to the introduction, the background, the methods, the results, the discussion, and the conclusion. So introduction, background are more likely to give you their motivation for writing this article or doing this research. The methods and the results are more objective. They're going to tell you how they did what they did and what they found. The discussion, they might talk about what that means for the field or where they'd like to see more research occur. And conclusion, they'll wrap up with what further research is needed to support this hypothesis or this research. So that is hopefully helpful when approaching an article. Now, research is not a straight path. It's a winding road, and that's why librarians and your professor are here to help. So I strongly encourage you to reach out to me, to make an appointment with me, email me for any reason if you're searching and it doesn't make sense to you and you need a little bit of help. So my contact information is on the next slide, and I thank you for watching and thank you for your time.